Tax incentives don't necessarily attract investors, experts say. Ugandan entrepreneurs celebrate Global Entrepreneurship Week. Rwanda Central Bank raises lending rate to 6.5%. More Kenyan firms facing liquidation. Nigeria to roll out new banknotes. So, a recent central bank report released did indicate that exports to China from Uganda grew to about $24.68 million. That's an equivalent to about 95 billion shillings. That is from 6.58 million to, let's say, about June. That's about now 25 billion shillings. And the Exports Promotions Board will tell you that if anything to go by, this should be going ahead. I'm talking about the numbers increasing. And then we come to the recent conversation of the quota from China, the free platform that should allow Ugandans export to China for free. The big question, however, should be, can our traders maximize this opportunity? And are they even ready to embrace this opportunity? Or are there some things that need to be done for them to benefit from this platform? If you speak to some people that have been to China, they will tell you that maybe this conversation is more clinical on the paper than actually it is in reality. Well, we'll just wait to see how this unfolds. And if it can help the business community, then it is definitely something that will be in the right direction. Welcome to the Business Show. My name is Simon. This is what you can expect on the show tonight.
The earlier you start saving, you will find that the more your savings work for you.
Once again, welcome to the show. Now, according to UNBS, as much as 54% of products sold in the Ugandan markets are either fake or counterfeit, or even substandard. It's interesting, fake, counterfeit, or substandard. Do you actually understand the difference amongst the three? Now, if you don't, this causes the country to lose up to 6 trillion shillings in revenue. That is every year, thanks to those dealing in counterfeit products. But worse still, today's challenge economy, the consumers tend to be the biggest loser, because in as much as most of them would want to go for something that is a bit cheaper, in the long run they are actually spending more money because the kind of product they are buying does not last. For instance, you buy a flat iron of about 50,000 and there is the other one of 100,000, and in less than 2 months you are replacing it. So in the long run, you're forced to spend more money that you should have actually spent once for something that is durable. But is there a solution? This week on Views from the Top, we are speaking to Stephen Obel, who is the CEO of Kweli.com. Now, this is a platform that is not only helping dealers buy products or consumers buy products that are of quality or of standard, but also it is helping them be able to get a warranty of the product they buy. For instance, if you bought something and doesn't work or it gets spoiled along the way, you have the opportunity to take it back and it's fixed. The amazing conversation on this interview, though, is that the biggest challenge for the e-commerce in this country, according to Stephen, is mistrust and not infrastructure, like most people would tell you. Here is that conversation with Stephen. Views from the Top.
I'm Stephen Obeli Samde. I'm the co-founder and CEO of Kweli.shop.
Okay.
Yes.
So Kweli.shop, Kweli is like, it's a Kenyan
Swahili word rather, sorry.
Yes,
that means real or truth.
Yes, sir.
And you're operating in Uganda. I think let's start from the choice of the name of the company and then what exactly does the company do?
Okay, so Kweli is a Swahili word which means truth. And we just use a Swahili word just to get the name from Swahili, because we realized that the problem that we had to deal with was actually far beyond Uganda. It was far beyond Uganda, and the nearest that it could go or that we could take it was East Africa. And the common language for East Africa is Swahili. So we decided to go with something that the majority of people in East Africa could more easily relate with. Yes.
So that is the name of the company. And what exactly does the company do then?
So Kweli.shop is a safe online marketplace for genuine consumer durables.
Let's first talk to that, the impact that you people coming on with this platform that operates not physically. How has this been for you? You talk about the rating, really, which is amazing as well. But you know, there's many people that are probably doing the same thing. So what do you think makes your rating high, and how has the journey been through that COVID time?
Wow. I'll start from the point of the rating, us getting to that point in customer reviews. It's been because we've been intentional about how we serve the customers. One thing that that we use as our mantra, and one thing that we give to every other person, is that, you know, do not try to sell what you cannot buy. Do not try to give a service in a way that you wouldn't want to receive a service. We do not want that when we send an inquiry to any business that we're dealing with, that we get a response after 1 hour or 2 hours or 24 hours. We want it to be instant. We do not want that when we go to buy shoes or to buy a washing machine or to buy a cooker, that we are going to be given 2 options or 10 options, like it is on some online platforms, you know. You go and you find a 120 liter refrigerator, and there's one of 370,000, another one of 400,000, another one of 600,000, another one of the same brand.
At different prices.
Different prices, you know? Mm-hmm. As customers, we think that is dishonesty. So we've made sure that in everything that we are doing, we are true, first to ourselves and then to our customers. And at the end of the day, the customers have come to appreciate that. Mm. And that's why they give us very, very good reviews.
So talking about reviews, I know you have another question to answer.
Yes.
So you are simply saying, even if your business operates, even if you're operating online, there is need for truth. Because I know for a fact that, like you said, you go to a site and the same product has different prices. And if you choose the other one, the guy just delivers it to you and that's it. For a business person, what is the impact along the way if you keep doing that and you're not helping the client?
Okay, if you keep doing that, the thing is, the business would fail.
But I'm making quick money, yeah?
Yeah, you'll make quick money, and quick money won't take you so far.
Hmm.
Quick money won't take you so far. There's a saying that if you want to go faster, go alone.
Yeah.
If you want to go far, then go with others.
Mm.
But going with others usually is a little bit slower, because in the group, some are slower. Likewise, in business, if you want to do everything quickly so that you make money quickly, you know, you want to put things in a way that maybe people might get confused and then they might just make a decision, snap. Like you put same product, different prices, and then you say, you know, this is a quick sale. In online shopping, it's called a flash sale.
Mm.
This, you can only buy it between 10 a.m. and 10:15 a.m. Beyond that, the price changes, you know? So the customer will get a little bit confused, and then they'll end up just ordering, and they have that. At the end of the day, if they're not happy with what they bought, remember what I said? Consumer durables, These are products that typically last not less than 3 years. Now, if within 6 months or within 1 year, the product has broken down, then what happens? You know, the customer will not come back to you. And remember, you want to stay in business for long, if at all you're going to survive, and if the business will as well outlive you.
Okay, so, you emphasize the fact that honesty is very key for anyone that wants to engage in online business, which is generally even for any other business person. Yeah. So apart from the fact that you've been able to follow that, what else do you think has enabled your platform Tick?
There's one very interesting one. I must tell you that there has been God in it from the beginning, because there are moments that we didn't prepare for. And I think you asked that in the question that we were leaving. You asked about COVID, how it impacted our business and all of that. COVID impacted our business in a very good way. But I can tell you, we didn't know that it was coming. So we just prepared to run business normally. So when COVID came, first our suppliers sent us notices that they would be closed. So we thought, what shall we do? You know, here we were just getting into the second year and suppliers are closing. People want to buy goods online, but the suppliers are closing. So really, where would we go? You know, so in that kind of moment, we didn't know what we would do. We were in a state of confusion, but in a way, God worked things out for us. God worked out things for us. Everybody says that online shopping was boosted by COVID, by the lockdowns and all that. Can tell you for a fact, there was an e-commerce store. It was about number 2 or number 3 in Uganda, and it closed on about March 20th, 2020. As the president was announcing a lockdown, they were closing and they closed for good.
What does that mean?
It means that to a good extent, and I do not mean to preach here, but to a good extent,
yes,
God has helped us and helps many other people that are in business to actually make it through. Now, going to the other things that majority of the people, they look at as the more practical ones. I can tell you that if we had not followed through on our faith with practicality and consistency, we would have not made it through. As COVID came, one thing became very peculiar, that lots of people were shopping online. But these people were not patient. They were not. They wanted something. If they didn't have it now, they would find it somewhere else. They had all the time to themselves. So they were all over, they were browsing. Sometimes a delivery person would get to the customer's home and the customer is still browsing online. The customer is still, and then the customer asks for a discount at the time of delivery. You know? So we made sure that as we got opportunities to secure products and continue making deliveries through COVID, every order that came, we would fulfill it as it came. We wouldn't wait for anything. And we did that consistently. Even after COVID ended, we kept doing that consistently like that. And to this day, as we're having this interview, Kweli.shop delivers across the country faster than any retailer in this country.
Okay.
I can tell you for a fact, we can deliver to any district in Uganda before Postal Uganda delivers a letter to that district. And I mean delivering bigger players.
I can imagine that. I can imagine that.
Yeah, so being practical, being consistent, those have really worked for us. Yeah.
Which is interesting because, you know, we did mention it at the start of the interview that there are platforms that offer different products and you wonder, okay, which one do I take? And then, so my question to you is going to be, how then are you able to know that I am working with supplier A and whatever they are giving us to put up are of quality?
So, there are various things to consider. Number one, I have to put it as a disclaimer. Quality is something that is very, very subjective. Everyone has their own idea of quality. Everyone has their own idea. And then there's also this thing of genuine.
Okay.
That is it authentic? Is it the real one? Or it is a copy, or it is similar to the real one. Now, if we are to talk about just quality, that one I would say that you would first look at the one that is providing it to you. You might have to just trust them if you're not going to touch and feel the product. You should be able to trust them. Even if you're going to touch and feel the product, if you do not know so much about those particular range of products, you will not still be able to know much. I myself, before we started Quelly, I had experiences where I bought shirts, where I bought shoes that turned out to be fake. And it was all because of one thing, that I was buying from total strangers. I didn't buy online, meanwhile. I bought from total strangers and I didn't care whether I trusted them. I was like, well, I don't have many choices, so I'll just get. So I can say, first thing, ask yourself, can I trust these guys? If you can't trust them, then they are wrong. Now, for us as a business, one thing that we believe that we are doing and that we want to continue doing for many more people in Uganda, in East Africa, and across Sub-Saharan Africa, is that we are helping you as a customer to get what is right. Because you may not be as street smart as you need to be to get a genuine, good quality product. In this day and age of ours, you're very busy people. By the time you go shopping, maybe you've got about 15, 20, 30 minutes and you can't keep, you know, going from store to store to store to store to another store, then another mall, and then all of that. We are representing you. So we cannot just say, well, trust may take us a lot of time to build.
So listening to Stephen, one thing stands out, and he does say if there are people that know that the counterfeits are on the market, that there's just need to move out and have them eliminated. Look, if e-commerce as an industry in this country is to pick up, then we should stop pretending that we are covering up. How many times do you click on a page and all you see are several products that look to be the same but different prices on them? So that leaves the client wondering, what then should they do with the online products, and should they actually even trust the business or the different products that are being sold on the sides? Maybe it's something that the guys that are participating on the online or e-commerce business should pay attention to ensure that moving forward they look into trust over anything else. And this, in the long run, should be able to help us grow the industry. All right? You're watching The Business Show with me, Simon. Time now for a quick break. We have a lot lined up for you, including in personal finance. We'll be telling you how to invest and saving. The question is just how much is important for you to save. That and more after the break. Don't go so far away.